guys. Today we will continue our discussion on semiconductor physics. Last class, what we have seen, based on the position of the valence band, conduction band, and the amount of the forbidden energy gap, the materials are classified into three different groups, that is conductors, insulators, and semiconductors. In the classification, we have seen, depending on the purity of the crystal or the material, semiconductors are of two types, that is intrinsic and extrinsic semiconductors. Today we will be discussing the intrinsic and extrinsic semiconductors in more detail. The types of semiconductor, what we have seen in the last class, that is semiconductors are broadly classified into two types, that is intrinsic semiconductor, which includes silicon, germanium, crystals, and the second category is extrinsic semiconductors, in which the pure silicon or germanium are doped with either group 3 or group 5 elements, and depending on whether we are using group 3 element or group 5 element, extrinsic semiconductors are of two types, that is p-type and n-type. P-type are doped with group 3 elements and n-type semiconductors are doped with group 5 elements. First, we will look into intrinsic semiconductor. Intrinsic semiconductors are nothing but the pure form of the crystals like silicon and germanium crystals, which are not doped with any other elements. Those are called as intrinsic semiconductors. And these intrinsic semiconductors have completely filled valence band and completely empty conduction band at 0 Kelvin. For example, if we are considering silicon, the atomic number is 14. And what is the electronic configuration? That is 284. About this, we have discussed in our last class. If you have not seen, you can go and see it. This is the electronic configuration of silicon. There are 14 protons inside the nucleus. In the first cell, that is K cell, there are 2 electrons. In the second cell, that is L cell, there are 8 electrons. And there are 4 electrons in the outermost cell, that is M cell. This is the atomic structure of a single silicon atom. In a crystal, what happens? Number of atoms are coming together, they are bonded together to form the crystals. What happens in case of silicon crystal? Here, if you can see, silicon is having 4 valence electrons, and according to octet rule, in a stable state, all the atoms, they try to get 8 electrons in their outermost orbit. Here, as they are having 4 electrons for silicon, it gets bonded with 4 nearest silicon covalently. That means here, this is the silicon. If I am considering, there are 4 silicons. This is the first one on the top of top, second one at the bottom, the third one at the right hand side, fourth one at the left hand side. And this silicon, this electron is covalently bonded with this upper silicon. Similarly, all the 4 valence electrons, they bonded covalently with 4 neighboring silicon atoms to get the octet state. Looking into the band structure at 0 Kelvin, if this is the valence band and this is the conduction band, as we have already discussed in the previous class, when the atoms are coming closer, there will be redistribution and splitting of the energy levels, and those splitted energy levels come together to form different bands, and the topmost occupied level is known as valence band and the lowest unoccupied band is known as conduction band. So these valence bands are completely filled and these conduction bands are completely vacant, and the gap between the valence band and conduction band is known as forbidden energy gap, that is EG. In the last class, I told that at 0 Kelvin, the semiconductors behaves like an insulator. Let us understand this point, why it is behaving like an insulator at 0 K. Here, if you can see, the valence band is completely filled. So all the energy states in the valence band are filled with electrons. So if this electron also wants to move, like in a musical chair, if all the seats are filled, then others cannot take the place. They cannot move from one to other place. Similarly here, if these electrons that try to move also, there is no available energy state to which they can move. So there is no movement of electrons in the valence band. Contrary, if we see in the conduction band, there are many energy states available there, but it is completely vacant. There is no electrons present in the conduction band. States are there, but who will move there? There is no electrons. When current flows through a material, whenever there is flow of electron, if there is no movement of electrons either in the conduction band or in the valence band, that means there is no flow of current, and hence it is behaving like an insulator. So near 0 Kelvin, it behaves like an insulator. Let us see what happens at a higher temperature. So if T is increasing above 0 Kelvin, what will happen? How it will behave like a conductor? That is the definition, that at 0K the semiconductors behaves like insulator, but as the temperature increases, the conductivity increases and it starts behaving like a conductor. As the temperature increases, what happens? Here you can see some of the bonds, because of the thermal energy, they breaks. If this bond is breaking, there will be a generation of electron hole pair. This is the free electron which was attached to the silicon. Because of the breaking of the bond, now it becomes free. And if the electron has moved from its place, there will be an empty space which is known as hole. So this is the free electron and this red one is a hole. So when a bond breaks, there will be one free electron and one hole will be generated. Now we'll see, understand this through this energy band diagram. So this is the valence band, this is the conduction band, and the gap between them is the energy gap. Because of that, the electrons which are at valence band, they cannot move into conduction band. But once they get the energy which is equal to or more than EG, they move to conduction band because their energy is now increased. When that amount of energy is increased above EG, these electrons is moving from this valence band to conduction band. Similarly, if this electron is also getting an energy which is more than EG, it will move to conduction band. Similarly, this also is moving to conduction band. So these electrons, they move from the valence band to conduction band as they have gained the energy which is equal to EG or more than that. When these electrons are moving from valence band to conduction band, they will be leaving behind an empty space which are known as holes. So these white spaces which are left after the movement of the electrons from the valence band to conduction band are known as holes. In this present scenario, what will happen? This electron will see there is an empty space. I can move there. How much shall I sit in a single place? Let me move. So this electron will move here. Similarly, this electron, it can move here. Once this electron moves from this place will become empty. And looking at this empty space, the other electron will move from here to this place. Okay. So there is a continuous movement of electron due to the creation of the holes in the valence band. And what about these electrons which reach the conduction band? Once they reach the conduction band, already there are many energy states lying vacant. So they can freely move from one place to other place. So there is a free movement of electrons in the conduction band. And here also, there is move of holes are contrary, I can tell electron, because holes are not moving. But if this electron is moving here, it seems that that hole is created over here. Earlier it was here and now the hole came to this place. That's what generally they are telling, holes are moving in the valence band and electrons are moving in the conduction band. But if you see, actually it is the electron moving in both the place. So here these electrons and these holes are known as the charge carriers or carriers in the semiconductors. And if n is the number of electrons, p is the number of holes, and ni is the intrinsic carrier concentration that we will be discussing further. So this, in case of intrinsic semiconductor, as we have seen, if one electron is moving from the valence band to conduction band, one hole is created over there. Similarly, if one more is moving from valence band to conduction band, one more hole is created at the valence band. That means the number of electrons moving from valence band to conduction band is same as the number of holes created inside the valence band. That means n in the conduction band, that is the electron concentration in the conduction band, is equals to the hole concentration in the valence band, and that is known as intrinsic carrier concentration, that is denoted by ni. What is extrinsic semiconductor? We have seen, when we are doping the pure silicon or germanium with either group 3 or group 5 elements, those are known as extrinsic semiconductors. First we will discuss n-type. N-type means here we are doping the semiconductor with group 5 elements. Here you can see these black ones are silicons, and here this red one, that may be like your arsenic, antimony, whatever, some group 5 element which is used for doping the semiconductor. So this red one is a group 5 atom. We know the group 5 elements, they are having 5 electrons in the valence cell. So here if it is having 5 electrons, and silicon needs 4 electrons to be going to octet state. So 4 of the electrons of this group 5 element are bonded with the 4 neighboring silicons, but a single electron is leaving behind, because there are 5, 4 are used in the bond, one left behind, and that electron is an extra electron which is freely moving in the crystal, that is attached to this group 5 element. But the force of attraction is very less. That means a small amount of energy can make this electron move freely. The n-type semiconductors are doped with pentavalent impurity like your phosphorus, arsenic, antimony, etc. What is the meaning of this pentavalent impurity? That means the number of valence electrons of these elements are 5. And what we have seen, that electron concentration is more compared to that of holes. If let some 10 to the power 22 elements of group 5 are added, that means already there are 10 to the power 22 electrons available before the creation of hole electron pair. And holes will come from that hole electron pair. That means the number of electron concentration is more compared to holes. The impurity is called donor impurity. Why it is called donor impurity? Because it is donating an extra electron. That's what the name is, donor impurity. These free electrons form an energy level called donor energy level below the conduction band. This is the valence band, this is conduction band, and below the conduction band there is an extra energy level which is known as donor energy level. Here these free electrons resides at this energy state. If you can see, there is a very small gap between the conduction band and donor energy level. Even a small amount of energy can make these electrons move to the conduction band. So if these electrons are moving to the conduction band, they will start moving in the conduction band, which leads to increasing conductivity of the material, and hence by doping the material we can increase the conductivity. Coming to p-type materials, here we are adding group 3 elements as dopants. These black dots over here are silicon atoms, and this blue one is a group 3 element like your boron. And what we have seen, silicon needs 4 electrons to achieve the octet state. Here this group 3 element is having 3 valence electrons because these are trivalence. So 3 electrons, they are shared with this right hand side, left hand side and lower silicon. But this upper silicon atom is having one electron which is not getting an electron to be shared with. This empty space over here is known as hole, because there is lack of one electron, and lack of electron is known as hole. So this is a hole over here. Basically, these p-type semiconductors are obtained by doping trivalent impurity like aluminium, gallium, indium, boron, etc. In case of n-type, we are getting extra electrons. Here we are getting holes over there. So hole concentration is more compared to that of electrons. The impurity is called acceptor impurity. There it was called donor impurity because they are giving extra electrons. But here hole can accept one electron. Whenever an electron is coming, it can sit over there. So that means it is accepting electrons, and hence the name is acceptor impurity. Here also one extra energy states is there level, and that is known as acceptor energy level, which is formed just above the valence band. The donor level was just below the conduction band, and here the acceptor level is just above the valence band. Here you can see, like there, with a small amount of energy, the donor electrons, they can move to the conduction band. But here what happens? With a small amount of energy, this electron can move to this place. Similarly, this electron can move to this place. Once these electrons are moving from this place, they will left behind the empty spaces, which are known as holes. When these holes are generated due to the movement of the electrons from valence band to acceptor level, these valence band electrons, they can move from one place to another place. And as the electrons are moving from one hole to another, it will appear like that the hole is moving from one place to another place. And that's what the carrier movement will be there inside the valence band, which leads to conduction in the semiconductor. Now let us summarize the difference between p-type and n-type semiconductors. For n-type, it is doped with pentavalent impurity, while for p-type, it is doped with trivalent impurity. Here in case of n-type, electrons are the majority carriers, whereas the holes are minority carriers. And the reverse is true for p-type. In p-type, holes are the majority carrier and the electrons are minority carriers. Here the meaning of majority means the major amount of the carriers are electrons in case of n-type, and few of holes are contributing to the conduction of electricity, and that's what the name is minority. But in case of p-type, the major charge carriers which are playing role in the conduction of electricity are holes, and electrons play very less role for the conduction, and hence they are known as minority charge carriers. In case of n-type, the impurity is called donor impurity, as it is donating the free electrons to the semiconductor, whereas in case of p-type, these are called accept are impurity because it is accepting, the holes are accepting electrons. The free electrons form an energy level called the donor energy level, which is below the conduction band in case of n-type. And in case of p-type, we are getting an energy level which is known as acceptor energy level, which is just above the valence band. Here in case of n-type, the Fermi level is close to the conduction band. It will lie between the conduction band and the donor level. But in case of p-type, it is close to the valence band. It will lie between the acceptor level and valence band. So these are the difference between n-type and p-type semiconductors. The details of the carrier concentration will be discussed further. Till that, go through these modules to have better understandings. Thank you all for your listening.